We meet in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, and also with you. Welcome to our service today. I'm the Reverend Mark Green from St Stephen's here in Moulton. Well, it's now July and we're still here. We're still doing lockdown services, but I'm going to start doing them from back here in St Stephen's. Now we're open for quiet prayer. So where I can, I'll come and record the service from in here. It may be that some of you have never been into St Stephen's. Maybe going to church every Sunday doesn't feel like your thing. But I know there'll be others who have been coming here every week for years, possibly decades. And for them, it's such an important place. As a building, the church is probably the most significant and beautiful building in our village. It's probably got the biggest footprint. And for me, it's a real privilege to be the person trusted to look after it and lead worship at this time. Some of you may have seen that services in church can start today, the 5th of July. In our local area, which is called Deanery, about 20% of those churches have started today. But at the moment, we're not. We're reviewing this, which is the 11 plus pages of guidelines that came out from the Church of England on Tuesday evening, along with another similar document from the government a few days earlier. And we're considering and praying about what reopening looks like for St Stephen's and what services would look like with the many restrictions there are, unfortunately, in the guidelines. So when we know what we're doing, we'll announce it here and in many other places. But please be assured our number one priority will be safety. Now, whether you have a faith or not, it's worth spending some time here in this church, St Stephen's, because it also reflects our rich heritage, the heritage of our village. We've got pictures of all the vicars that have ever been, going back to the 1870s. There are some pictures of the church with gas lighting hanging down from the ceilings, how it used to look. Over on that wall, there's an embroidered cloth with the names of everyone who came to church and the Mothers Union and the Cubs and the Brownies from the 1950s. And perhaps Pride of Joy is an Easter postcard from St Stephen's that was sent out to troops in World War I. But as well as the things that reflect our heritage, people find this place a place of real quietness, of calm, of peace, the chance to sit, to think and reflect in a different space away from the distractions and the noise of life. So until we reopen for services, we're going to be open every Monday from 1 till 2 p.m. and every Thursday from 5:30 to 6:30 for that quiet time for prayer. Yes, we have got some regulations that you'll need to follow, but you'll all be very welcome. Just please try not to all turn up at the same time. So now we're going to sing together as we sing along with a song that was recorded by our very own Kath and Dave, Oceans.
Thank you. Let me walk upon the water wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Saviour. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the water wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my
rise, my soul rest in your embrace, for I am yours, you are mine. Thanks,
Dave and Kath. We're now going to pray together by saying the special prayer for the day, known as the Collect. Gracious Father, by the obedience of Jesus, you brought salvation to our wayward world. Draw us into harmony with your will, that we may find all things restored in him, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're now coming to a time of confession, a time where we acknowledge the things that we've done that we probably instinctively know aren't right. I'm often aware that as I lead confession, and perhaps more importantly, forgiveness, it can be seen as if, well, I'm the person who does the forgiveness. There's nothing I need to confess. Well, trust me, there is things that I need to confess. I regularly get things wrong. So today we're going to have a different form of confession. I'm going to start off by confessing my failings to you. And then hopefully your response will assure me of God's forgiveness. And then we'll do it the other way round. Before God, with the people of God, I confess to my brokenness, to the ways I wound my life, the lives of others, and the life of the world. And you all say, may God forgive you, Christ renew you, and the Spirit enable you to grow in love. And we all say, Amen. And then you say, before God, with the people of God, we confess to our brokenness, to the ways we wound our lives, the lives of others, and the life of the world. So God forgive you, Christ renew you, and the Spirit enable you to grow in love. Amen. Steve is now going to bring us our Bible reading. And you'll notice that the tone of the reading this week is a bit different, perhaps much more contemporary. Now, there are literally dozens of different Bible translations out there. And the one I've chosen for today is one of the most recent ones, called The Message. And I felt it gives a whole new way of thinking about this passage. So thank you, Steve.
This morning's reading is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapters 11, verses 16 to 19, and then 25 to 30, and is taken from the Message translation. How can I account for this generation? The people have been like spoiled children, whining to their parents. We wanted to skip rope, and you were too tired. We wanted to talk, but you were always too busy. John came fasting, and they called him crazy. I came feasting, and they called me a lush, a friend of the riffraff. Opinion polls don't count for much, do they? The proof of the pudding is in the eating. Abruptly, Jesus broke into prayer. Thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. You've concealed your ways from sophisticates and know-it-alls, but spelled them out clearly to ordinary people. Yes, Father, that's the way you like to work. Jesus resumed talking to the people, but now tenderly. The Father has given me all these things to do and say. This is a unique father and son relationship. Coming out of the Father and the Son, intimacies and knowledge. No one knows the Son the way the Father does, nor the Father the way the Son does. But I'm not keeping it to myself. I'm ready to go over it line by line with anybody willing to listen. Are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover life. I'll show you how to take real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Steve. And I hear that last bit of that passage that Steve read. I'm wondering how many of us are tired and worn out. Perhaps we may also add fed up. I expect most of us. We're now in July, when we started lockdown in March, and even though some things are relaxing, it's clear that we're still in the middle of a health crisis, not just for this country, but globally. If you're working, it's possible that things have never been busier, particularly if you're a key worker. Or you may be at home, trying to educate and care for children who are really missing their friends and schoolmates. Or you may have been stopped from visiting dear friends and family. And as this lockdown eases, for many of us, it's only going to increase the anxiety. And for those businesses and organisations looking to reopen, they're going to find challenges they'd never even considered before. So those last couple of sentences then from the Bible reading today, when Jesus calls out to those who are tired and worn out, it seems to be calling directly to us. We're tired, I'm worn out. And yes, many of us are burned out from religion as well. The types of rules and regulations seemingly imposed by church or church leaders that might make faith so difficult gets in the way between us and God. So how sweet do those words of Jesus sound? Get away with me and you'll recover your life. Recover your life. Last week, the results of a poll were published that was supported by everyone from the CBI, the British Chambers of Commerce, through to the TUC and the former Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams. You may have seen it. It said only 6% of people want to return to how things were before the pandemic. Because we instinctively knew that something was wrong in the world. Those things that perhaps seemed important, that non-stop merry-go-round of us always wanting something more or something new, well, really, they've just been revealed as if they're the emperor's new clothes. They didn't actually do that much for us. What's important is how we are and how we act to those we share this world with. Those extraordinary acts of kindness and commitment that have been shown, the dedication of those closest to the pandemic, in particular those in our NHS, the way communities have come together to support those who are most vulnerable for all sorts of reasons. As the madness of the world was paused, we saw air pollution rapidly decline, waterways became clearer, we saw carbon levels decrease, we saw nature start to heal itself and recover its life. So we have an opportunity here, one that involves all of us. It's not just governments, but all of us finding a way where we can recover our lives. For many people who may be watching this service today or have watched others that we and many other churches have done during lockdown, it's also given them a time to think about their spiritual life. How do they feel about God and the difference that makes in their life? That difference at the moment feels like it's needed more than at any other time in recent history. Because those words from Jesus, gosh, don't they sound so idyllic now? Come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Think of those words, real rest, the unforced rhythms of grace. Nothing too heavy, nothing that feels wrong. We can live freely and lightly. How many of us can honestly say that's not how we want to live? Living freely and lightly, fully rested. That doesn't mean doing nothing, walking away from things we should do, our responsibilities. Jesus was very clear in that passage that we walk with him and work with him. It's not a passive thing, leave me alone, but it's working with him, resting and living lightly. It's living well with Jesus. And it is with Jesus. I think he's really important. Doing it by ourselves, trusting ourselves to get it right, well, that hasn't really worked, has it? We need Jesus to travel with us, to help to put it right when it does go wrong. And it's not overly complicated. God doesn't require us to get all deep and religious and theological. Indeed, a bit earlier in that passage, Jesus said, "You've concealed your ways from sophisticates and know-it-alls, but spelled them out clearly to ordinary people." Yes, Father, that's the way you like to work. In this time of huge, rapid change and uncertainty, the hope that there is in the faith and trust in Jesus can be our bedrock, our foundation. We've seen most of us want a life different to how it was. We don't want to work in the way where we were just there to accumulate more stuff whilst destroying the planet. We want to recover our lives. In John's Gospel, chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus says, "I came so they can have real and eternal life, more and better life than they ever dreamed of." And that's the difference Jesus makes, the fullest, best life you can think of forever. It takes some work. It's something I'm trying hard to achieve. It's not always easy, but I happen to think it's worth it. And I hope you do too. So if you're able to, perhaps because this has been your faith for years, or perhaps because what I've said or your reflections over this time has got you thinking, I'm going to invite you to say with me a statement of faith that will help us to understand that journey. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Grant is now going to bring us our prayers.
Good morning. Let us pray. In a world that at times seems to be overwhelmed with sadness and anxiety, let us pause and find a moment of peace and rejoice in the gift of this new day. We pray for our communities, for the elderly confined to their homes and separated from family and support, for those who have lost their source of income, for those who have no home, and for those offering everyday acts of kindness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for key workers, for all medical staff and hospital workers, who go to work knowing the risks they face, for medical researchers seeking ways to prevent and to cure, for care workers providing contact and support to those who have no other help. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, be with us in our time of need. We pray for the world, for the leaders of the nations and their governments, for areas most overwhelmed by the pandemic, for places where healthcare and resources are scarce and the pandemic brings further suffering. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we offer up our hopes and fears, our joys and sorrows, to God who is our refuge and strength. Lord, hear our prayers, as we who trust in your word eagerly await your help, for you are the God of our salvation. This we ask through your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's join together now in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
And we're now going to sing together that rousing hymn, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
And a final blessing. May Christ draw you to humility and worship and bring you to see God at work. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those you care for this day and always. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.